And we are live! Hello, PonyFest Online! Welcome to More Horse, More Friendship, a celebration of animation beyond friendship is magic, so to speak. We have a lovely cast of characters here today, and I would love to introduce them to you. So first of all, my name's Ford Progress from Keeping Friendship Magic. To my left,
I'm Nova Rose.
And joining us, we have some other lovely individuals from this community. I'd like to introduce you to, I guess you could say, the other Fuffster. I don't know what you want to say. I'm sure he's scowling at me. But hi, Thoth Penswell from Rift Ponies.
Hi, yeah, I am scowling at you. This is the only thing I'll ever be known for. No, hi, I'm Thoth Penswell. I'm one half of Riv Ponies. I'm also one half of TrotCon. Anyway, TrotCon. But most of all, I'm here to talk about shows other than Friendship is Magic. Weird. I didn't think that was a thing that existed, but very excited to be here. Very excited to talk about some really incredible examples of an incredible example of animation outside Friendship is Magic. I keep wanting to say witchcraft for some reason. I don't know why. It keeps almost slipping out. But yeah, I'm really excited. Really excited to talk about, you know, things I love about animation, things I take from it with other people who are extremely talented and talk about what they love about it. So really excited to be here.
Thank you again for joining us. And also joining us today is somebody you can find in the vendor hall with some amazing wares that I highly recommend. It is the one and only Baja Griffin.
Oh, hi, everybody. I'm really short. You can't see the rest of me right now. But hi, my name is Baja. I am an artist and animator in the community. I do a lot of art for your little horse cons. I think you might have heard of those before. Yeah, I sell a lot of good stuff. Vendor Hub, so happy to talk about stuff outside of horse too. Because honestly, when horse ended, I'm like, what next? I couldn't find anything I liked. And all of a sudden, all the stuff I started to like appeared. And I'm like, yes, so cool.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
There's always more content.
Thank you for having me on.
Definitely. And last but certainly not least, joining us, you can catch them in about 12 hours performing for you guys, is the one and only Bolt the Super Pony.
Hello. Yes, I actually didn't have an intro prepared. I am Bolt the Super Pony. I will be performing tonight, actually, at 1:15 Central, 2:15 a.m. Eastern Time. And I'm here to talk about the music side of Centaurworld. It's got a lot of great music in it, and I'm really excited to talk about that. So, yeah, thank you guys. Thank you for having me on.
Absolutely. All right. So let's get into the meat and potatoes of what we're talking about here today. So first of all, you guys might have heard of a little show called My Little Pony Friendship is Magic. Maybe.
Never heard of it.
Well, you see, it's about ponies.
What? That's crazy.
I know, right?
You watch a show about ponies?
I know, it's crazy.
With different little girls? No. Yeah. I can't even do that ironically anymore.
I'm losing
the ability, man.
I know. So, Friendship is Magic, let's face it, it was pretty revolutionary as far as animation goes. For a show to go over 200 episodes, 9 seasons of this nature was something nobody expected. Nobody expected this community. And it broke a lot of ground for bringing together a community of people, for bringing together a way of communicating and a way of just commenting on themes of friendship, of togetherness, of uniting in a positive way and overcoming some of just these life's little challenges and the great villains of the world. And since My Little Pony Friendship is Magic premiered, guys, it's been over 11 years now. Over 11 years since this show premiered. Isn't that insane to think about?
I was going to say, just play the scene from The Last Crusade where the guy drinks from the wrong grail and he shrivels up into a skeleton. That's me every time I hear that. I'm old, man. They've been in this long time.
Yeah. Born 2000, so yeah.
Yeah, it's insane, right? But here
half of my life.
We are still right? here. But
gosh,
here's the thing: is since Friendship is Magic has aired, a lot has come along the way that's really kind of picked up on these themes of friendship and kind of uniting and dealing with our differences and overcoming them to be stronger. So, you know, we've had a few over the years you may have heard of. 2013 Steven Universe premiered, and so much I could say about that series, about just taking these really abstract themes of so much going on. You had alien gems and human hybrid and all of the stuff that seems really on the surface, but at the end of the day, it's all about this boy who wants to just see everybody get along. And I think that's something a lot of us could vibe with, and it really took a lot of that stuff that was in the culture of the air that was started by Friendship is Magic and kept it going. Couple of years later, you got the 2017 reboot of DuckTales, which not only dealt with themes of friendship, but it also delved into what family really means. And I'm going to talk about DuckTales in various panels at various times because I love it. And if you're a DuckTales fan too, trust me, give me a follow. I love it. I will not stop talking about it. It's an amazing series. And just talking about making a family and what it really means to be family. And it's kind of an extension of friendship and what we learned in Friendship is Magic. You saw throughout DuckTales. Oh yeah, and it doesn't hurt that also horse representation, everybody. Hooray, horses!
I like a few horses. I like a good,
yes. So,
like a good Philly Fantasia. Every once in a while in there.
Exactly. Not really.
I've only ever watched one episode.
Of note, if you didn't already know, you see these little pink and purple pony-like creatures on the screen. Those were voiced by Tara Strong and Andrea Libman. So you had the pony voice actors over here playing ponies again in DuckTales. The ironic thing is Tara Strong played the pink one and Andrea Libman played the purple one. Isn't that?
I thought that was a fun choice.
Yeah.
And that really is a testament to add in. That's really a testament to how much of an influence on the popular culture that Pony was having, not only on the show, but to get referenced in that manner.
Exactly.
So soon after it premiered. Yeah.
So you have DuckTales, another series, great series, strong themes, friendship, family. 2018, She-Ra and the Princesses of Power came out. Dealt with a lot of things about learning about relationships and coming together when you started out as odds and overcoming obstacles. A lot of themes you found in Friendship is Magic also were found throughout She-Ra. And also, let's talk about Swiftwind for a second, shall we? This glorious, I said I wasn't going to use this word, but dare I say, you know, himbo culture right now is a big topic word. But this beautiful horse, who, let's face it, he's technically an alicorn, right? And just had this lovable sense about him and was still goofy and had some comic relief. But there was a lot of great things about him that I felt kind of was a takeoff of Friendship is Magic as well. And throughout a lot of characters in this series, kind of your main trilogy of characters were really dealing with relationships and having their friendship tested very strongly throughout that series. And also the relationship, I would say, between Adora and Catra in that series. And Adora having this sense of, like, not wanting to give up on someone in Catra. I mean, would you agree? Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And I'm noticing these shows that you're bringing up have a certain theme of a certain animal occurring throughout
all of them. There's a lot of horse involved. Or I should say animals in general, because the next one I wanted to mention was Kipo and the Age of Wonder Beasts, a beautiful series that finished up, I want to say, it was either the end of last year or early this year. But beautiful, beautiful show about kind of a ragtag group. It's kind of almost post-apocalyptic, you could say, in a way. You just like
I would say so, yeah.
Yeah.
I would say so.
But kind of finding a uniting force. And I'm noticing a lot of things about some of the characters in these series I brought up is you have this central theme of these characters that are just believing in the power of friendship and magic and positivity and uniting people and battling enemies that, you know, were kind of fighting back against that and using fear manipulation as their tools in a sense, you know? And it's a lot of themes you saw in Friendship is Magic carrying over once again into these series.
Right.
But the one we want to talk about the most today is the newest of the bunch that just premiered in July. And that is Centaurworld.
Yay! I'm just watching Baja's screen. I don't know if it's coming across on the stream, but I'm just watching characters appear.
Oh my gosh, it's beautiful.
Great little action figures.
Exactly. Collect them all, kids.
Don't worry.
Catch them all.
Your own little story.
There is a story. We just wrote a movie in the panel before this, so anything's possible.
All right. More horse, more movie. So,
exactly. We need more horse movie.
Has a lot of connection to Pony. And a good friend of ours, Kermit the Grog, if you've ever seen any of our content before, you've known us to collaborate with him, said to me recently that he feels like Centaurworld was just kind of designed to pick up where, you know, Friendship is Magic kind of left off as far as to be really going into this community and developing in different ways themes about friendship and identity and everything that we've seen. So we're going to dive deeper into Centaurworld today and talk about a lot of the things with it. And speaking of connections to Friendship is Magic, these two look familiar to you. We got Megan McCarthy, who... Let's face it, Megan McCarthy is the one that took the torch from Lauren Faust to keep Friendship is Magic going. And
definitely
has done a lot to really make the series what it has been.
It's
and
true.
Now she's involved with Centaurworld. So she's kind of taken the lessons that she learned from Friendship is Magic into this new series. And then we have the one and only Kimiko Glenn. Now, if that name sounds familiar, there's a reason for that, y'all. This pony right here. That's right. The voice of the main character in Centaurworld, known simply as Horse, is Kimiko Glenn, who also voices the one and only Izzy Moonbow. And
it's like 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon, except Horse.
We could make that again, dude.
Game 6 degrees of Kimiko Glenn.
Let's make it happen. What 6 degrees of Kimiko Glenn? That wasn't exactly where it was going to go, but that could happen.
That's a TrotCon panel. Anyway.
So, that being said, let's dive into it, everybody, shall we? So, we're going to dive in. Now, before we get too far into diving in, we want to give you a spoiler alert. We're going to be talking about the series. We're going to get into detail. Essentially, the longer this panel goes on, the more spoilery it gets. And we're going to give you a warning before it gets super spoilery here towards the end again. But I wanted to say that here, we're going to start general, get more specific here. So if you start being like, hey, I really dig this, but I don't want to get spoiled on things that happen. There's a point where, you know, if you step away, we completely understand. We get it. We wanted to be fair and warn you that some of the things we talk about are going to be from midway through the season and such. So,
yeah. And if you do, and that's kind of the point of this panel too. So if you do step away, we've done our job. We convinced you to go watch Centaurworld. You'll see all of this for yourself and discover it firsthand.
Yep.
Exactly.
And also I'll say this too. If you watch this and you even try the series and go, the series isn't for you, so be it. Not every series is for everybody. There's definitely, while we talk about the themes of friendship here, this is not My Little Pony. I think we can all agree on that, right?
They mentioned vodka in the first episode.
It's interesting, and then that's the way I always look at media there, just to detour super quick, is that we, you know, we've had people, when we talked about this panel, we've had people say that they weren't big fans of it and they didn't really see the same spark in it as Pony, and that's completely fine. And that's kind of a running theme that will come through it, is acceptance and those differences. It's great.
Absolutely.
It's great. Totally. Watch all of these shows we're talking about. Y'all have seen them. What am I talking about?
So let's dive in here, talk a little bit about the overall story here. So in essence, Centaurworld is an isekai of sorts, about where your main character gets transported to another world. Though what we're traditionally see, especially in anime, is, you know, maybe you're unexpecting, unassuming, sometimes slacker kid, human, might I add, usually getting transported to another world. Here, it's a horse, aptly named Horse.
Naturally.
Horse is our main character, as you can see on the right there. At least on my right. I don't know how it's coming across, if it mirrors on y'all's screen. But Horse here gets transported from her world into Centaur world. And essentially what we have here is Horse kind of serves as your Twilight Sparkle allegory here in this sense. But it's kind of kicked up a notch. And that's one of the big things I find in this series, is I feel like a lot of the stuff that we talk, that we find in Friendship is Magic, there's similar themes, but everything is kicked up to an extra high level. And so Horse here doesn't just come from a world, you know, just where Twilight came from Canterlot and just was a bookworm. Horse comes from a land that's ravaged by war.
She wants to go crush skulls under her hooves.
Exactly. Like, she, her life is battle. And her rider, who we only know as Rider, is a female who is, I don't know exactly how to describe her. She's, Rider just rocks and is like the strongest battle person I've ever seen.
Right.
And essentially here, though, events transpire where, for all intents and purposes, Horse kind of falls through a portal to another world, to Centaur world. And being transported from a world that is war, knowing nothing but war and battle, and going into this world of color and brightness and just something different, is very much a shock. And I got a small clip here to show you.
Rider! Where are you? This has got to be a dream. I just must have passed out in the battlefield or something. Where's the war? Oh, this is so weird. Why is everything so clean and colorful? Wide open spaces freak me out. Where are all the soldiers? What door? What door? Mommy, who was that?
I don't know. Probably some kind of weirdo.
So essentially here, you have a character looking to get home. But there's a lot more that happens within here. Is you have this freaked out character who's looking to get home that meets an interesting cast of characters. And I want to turn it over to our friend Thoth to talk about the writing of the series and kind of how that develops beyond this point. So take it away, Thoth.
Can do. Right. So to go right off from that clip, the thing I really admire about the show immediately from the start, because when we originally went into it, when a friend of mine, an artist friend of mine, and a bunch of us were hanging out one weekend, and it was like, hey, this show, it will probably be goofy, silly, absurdist fun, and that'll be it. And it was like, sure, we'll watch a few episodes. And as you get into it, you quickly realize that there is a really incredible story that I really appreciated, where it is this, sometimes quite literal in that clip, we pointed it out when, as we were prepping the panel, is that there is literally a fish out of water in that sequence. And that kind of sends the message home that it starts out as a fish out of water story, which I love that. But then you also, as you go through this series of Horse discovering this new world and discovering new people in a world that works completely different in this fish out of water setting, you find these themes of like finding yourself and discovering yourself and accepting yourself, which are really, really powerful things that we did not expect to get into when we heard the title of the show was Centaurworld, and we thought it would be wacky cartoon fun. The funny thing is, it is wacky cartoon fun, but then as Forward described, you have this character where immediately from the start is from this inciting character. At page one is like a warhorse wants to crush skulls beneath their hooves, as Rose said. But then it's this arc that leads to finding the people that you're meant to be with and finding what your true self is, even if you're really scared and kind of terrified of expressing that true self, which is covered in the show too. It's great. Not going to spoil anything, although I'm sure we'll go into it later. But for now, what I'll say is I just adore these two worlds clashing and this character who is from one world encountering this new world and encountering, kind of running into a lot of, having a lot of the values from this world where you can't show any weakness, you can't show any softness, and you're encountering this warmth of this cartoon world and this crazy world that still has bad things happen, of course. I won't go into that, but bad things can still happen in the crazy, kooky cartoon world. But the mixing of that, you know, really mature and kind of enforcing, like, not masculine things, but, like, you know, you can't show emotion, you can't show any kind of weakness, and then kind of cracking through that and saying, hey, it's okay to be a little bit goofy and to kind of let yourself be shown emotionally or anyhow. That's really powerful to me. And that struck me, you know, that was a connecting thread with Megan McCarthy working on it as well. I'm sure that factored in, that connected it from Pony to that, where it's still really mature themes in the middle of the colorful cartoon horse show. Half horse show, I guess. But yeah, that was the thing that drew me in. And it quickly turned that weekend, where it was a couple of our friends were like, it'll be a lark. It'll be silly slapstick fun. It went from let's watch one or two episodes to no, we need to watch all 10 tonight. We need to watch all of them tonight because the story's gripping and the arcs are gripping. There's actual characters in conflict here. Oh my God. So any series that can do that turn on me is, to me, worth every single praise in the book. You know, it really impressed me, and I can't stress that enough. It impressed me in a way that Pony did at the start.
Absolutely, I would totally agree with that. And we're gonna get towards the end here, we're gonna get a little bit deeper about some things that affected us each personally and little bits of the story, but we wanted to keep it general at first as we go.
Right. I'm being very general with a lot of surprises that you'll find throughout it.
Absolutely.
I've already seen somebody in the chat is like, I'm already sold, and I'm like, good. Good. I'm glad. Absolutely. I'm glad we've got you already.
So that being said, we've got a lot of other great things we want to talk about. So I do want to turn it over to our friend Bolt here, who's going to talk a little bit about the music of the series, because boy, is music central to this show. Am I right, Bolt?
Very much so. Yes, you are very, very right about that. And I'll just say off the bat, I'm not a music theorist, so I'm not going to be getting into like the technical stuff. And I am also going to be keeping it kind of vague surface level, so I don't get into any spoilers. And then there are going to be certain stuff I'm just not even going to cover because of spoilers. Because it's so good. It's like, you should really just experience it for yourself. But yes, the music is such an integral part of the show. And much like in My Little Pony, it is a normal part of this world, to the point where characters will just like burst into song at the drop of a hat and not even really blink twice about it. And that's something that Horse had to get used to and was very much not used to it in the first song in the episode. And she picked up on it. The music in the show can either be like, it adds a lot of emotional depth to a lot of the scenes, And as I was re-listening to the soundtrack this morning, I found myself actually like crying as I was listening to it, just because it's just so impactful. And I wasn't even watching anything. I was just listening to it, and that alone was enough to bring tears to my eyes. And it was like 12 o'clock. It was noon. I just got up at 11, and I'm already crying. I'm like, oh no, this is a great start to the day. But yeah, and some examples of that would be like Writer's Lullaby, which you hear in the first episode. I've Been Searching for You, which is a song that appears later on. That one actually, like, that was one of the ones that actually got me. I got emotional just listening to them. There are so many harmonies in a lot of the songs of the show. If you know me, I'm a huge sucker for harmonies. I love a good harmony, and they're very common in this show. I just wanted to point that out. It's one of the little things I love. They put kind of goes along with that musical vibe that the show has. I've got specific songs too that I can cover. Yeah. There are different genres represented in the show. If you're listening to the track, I counted rock, blues, gospel, folk, a cappella if you count that, Broadway if you count that, and rap. Mm-hmm. There are probably more, but those are the ones that I got. Let's see. Multiple points. The writing of the songs themselves is really clever, because at multiple points in different songs, they'll kind of do like fake outs. So they'll make you think they're going to say one thing and then they don't. So it kind of makes you question, wait, why did my mind just go there?
It's playful. It's playful. And like Pony, you know.
Can we talk about the fart song?
That's the one I was thinking of.
It's funny. It's funny that's mentioned, because someone is mentioning, so preface, going to the writing a little bit, and it relates to songwriting too. There are some fart jokes in the show. But it was funny because me and my friends, we are not a fan of that either.
No, I'm
there
not
are
either.
Key, right, there's key, there are key moments where they do that. But it's funny, as all of us were watching it, we're also like, but it's also self-aware that it's going there. So it's not as if it's like, oh, they're doing this to be lowbrow. That's the thing, is that there is a surrealism to the writing and the comedy of it, where they are self-aware of that. So if they go there, for example, if they sing a song about farts, they're doing it self-aware. And that kind of relates to what Bolt is talking about, where the songs are playful, and they... To me, immediately, I was like, it felt like Pony. It felt like, oh, this is why I loved the music in Friendship is Magic, because there's different styles they're working with. Every song feels like a totally new thing, a new piece of art to it. It also moves the story along. And sometimes there, I don't think this is a spoiler, really, but it's not as if it's regimented and scheduled, where Pony would have like one song, maybe a reprisal at some point if it was a two-parter or however so. But sometimes there are multiple songs in an episode, and that's to move the it feels really natural. It just happens because it's telling the story. It's less about, you know, it's less about we're going to put a song in, and instead it's there's a song here, but it's really powerful and really gorgeous, and it really makes the scene. It puts a pin in it. You can speak more to that, Bolt, because you know more about music than me. To me, I just hear music and I'm like, oh, it's so good. But, you know.
No, that's exactly, that is a good point, and one I wanted to bring up, is that in My Little Pony, you have songs that are like about what's happening. And you have that in Centaurworld too, but in Centaurworld you also have songs that, like you said, advance the scene and tell that story. So much to the point, and I'm looking at the slides that are on the stream on my phone right now, that if you Google Centaurworld, it comes up as musical theater, and very appropriately so, because every single episode has like three or four songs in it, and they all, in some way, shape, or form, help advance the story. Some of them are just silly for fun songs, and there were a couple that I was hearing as I re-listened to the soundtrack, but they still add to the scene. Those are going to be the ones that are kind of like what you have in My Little Pony, where it's just like, hey, here's a song about what's happening right now. It doesn't really advance the story, but it's just kind of, you know, situational. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so definitely that's a huge part of the show. And to that extent, I wanted to add too that all of these songs could very easily translate into a Broadway musical. And
oh yeah,
if this was on Broadway, I would 110% go see it. I would love to see that.
So real quick, we did want to give you guys a taste. We didn't want to do a whole song for multiple reasons, Twitch TOS aside, because we love this stream and we don't want anything to happen to it. But we wanted to at least play a little
fair use
from the first episode. Real quick here, it's not the full song, but it's a little taste here. Also to make sure that we stay on track because we have a lot more to talk about yet. So let's play a little sampling here.
You're okay. You're all right. I'll find you there beyond the line. But it takes a little boldness and a little bit of magic. I'd go on my own if only I had it. Yeah, it takes a little boldness and a little bit of magic. I'd go on my own if only I had it. Your magic, that is. Together we'll go into the unknown. So say bye to the old. And hello to that rainbow.
She can really build it.
Like, oh, Kimiko yeah. Glenn? Absolutely. I mean, this is how a unicorn walks. Walks. Anyway. we'll give you another minute here if you wanted to kind of touch on that song, because I know you talked about it when we had our meeting for this.
Yes, that song is a like perfect example. It's one of my favorite songs. I would almost say it's tied for first in my favorite songs. But what the show will do in the music is they will have callbacks to previous songs and sometimes even previous episodes. And that song is a perfect example of that, because in the beginning, you hear a callback to Writer's Lullaby, which is, I believe, the first song you hear in the show. So it's a really, it stops this kind of like progressiveness of the track, and it harks back to this emotional moment of the show. And hearing it for the first time, kind of, it's... not whiplash. It's whiplash in the best sense, because it kind of plays with your emotions, but it's really good. And then there's another. They do that going through the episodes too. So
absolutely.
And then towards the end, you get a little sample of like some harmonies, which is like makes for a really powerful build up onto the next stage of their journey. So I really appreciate that song for a number of reasons.
Absolutely. So we've talked about the writing. We've talked about the music. Let's talk about the art and the animation. And for that, we brought in the one and only Baja Griffin. I will let you take the stage and talk all about some amazing just art and animation and how they did it on the series. So,
yeah, definitely. This show really... It definitely, looking at that promo image, you're like, what the heck is this? This is a little weird. Character designs look, what is it, the trending term Kellert style, even though that's really not correct. But anyways, this was animated actually by two studios. Sometimes they invite studios, like animation productions will invite studios if they do like a... Sometimes they do like little bits, like you know how some do like anime cutscenes, like as a joke. Sometimes they'll actually bring in an anime studio to animate that. But actually, the two worlds, the world where Horse comes from, is animated by Red Dog Culture House, which is an animation studio in Korea. They actually worked on Voltron. I picked some of the more popular examples, and they did the Doomfist promo for Overwatch. They worked on more like action, more hand-drawn, and you'll definitely see the difference when you watch how much just the different technique of animation helps assist the story on its way. And it's definitely really cool. They really experience in action. So that was a really cool thing to bring in another studio for. So it helps the worlds even contrast even more. So I found out Mercury Filmworks actually just changed their logo and actually just put their old one in there. But Mercury Filmworks actually are really, really good. A lot of the shows that they've done, if you've seen Hilda, which is also on Netflix, is animated by them. And one example, which I think is kind of the closest, quote-unquote, to Centaurworld, is Rapunzel's Tangled Adventure. Merely a lot of it music-based. They have a lot of experience taking these kind of rigged puppet-esque animation, a set animation, and making it look so fluid that sometimes you're like, is this hand-drawn? It can't be. Megan McNicoldong, Sketch Shark, that's actually the creator of Centaurworld and the voice of Glendale. She sent an interview. It was really fun to work with these two studios. We sent them each other's work to inform them what the other was doing. None of us have ever worked like that before, with two different studios that work with such different styles. They were also collaborative, and it was a really interesting process. And that's really cool, because, you know, the two different parts of the world, Canada and Korea, and I guess I found it kind of cute that they were like, hey, look what they're doing. They're like, oh, that's so cool. And seeing them styles blend, you probably wouldn't even really notice it when you're watching. And they both did such a fantastic job. The animation is just, you can stare at GIFs for hours.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
No joke. Yeah. Like, it is so good.
Seriously.
So, even if you don't like it at all, it's like the Raggedy Ann and Andy thing, where you just watch it because it looks so good.
Right.
Yeah.
Half animal, half man thing. Of course, as you see in some of the clips, why does horse have not the same line width as Llama Link? Excuse me, that's an animation error. No, it wasn't. So, with the contrast of different worlds, their direction was taking on different art styles. Each design has different rules in animating, even though those rules can be obviously broken. I love the horse face I chose here.
It's really good.
It's great, eh? So horse looks has more realistic-esque proportions for a cartoon horse. Sorry, Twilight. I really love... It's hard. It's hard to animate something like this. Especially horses. Horses can be quite a bit of a challenge to animate, especially in a more realistic style. There's so much more you gotta think about, especially in volume. With shading, they went with the simple, like, flat shading. It really blends... Man, I rehearsed this, and now I'm like, ugh! But anyways. And I think it really complements a lot of the hard edges that she has. You can see a lot of the lines have a very consistent width. Not as much line weight. It's just a consistent line weight. So you don't really see much tapering at the ends, which is kind of like the little points at the end. So... kind of giving an edge on this character that, this is me. I'm strict. I'm built. well, look at Llama Link. Look how thick those lines are. Those lines are like used. Blah 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 blah. So a lot of the line work of the Centaur characters and Centaur World itself uses a lot of textured line work using a specific brush. And that's something that gives it a little bit more character to it. Gives a little unevenness, as you can tell, with Llama's front leg and the other legs being a different line consistency. It kind of plays into their characters and who they are. You know, a lot more loose, a lot more fun, a lot more toony. And something I noticed yesterday while making this is that Llama Link's tummy actually is not fully lined. So there's this kind of blob of color that's kind of peeking out. And I kind of like that. It kind of shows how freeform, how crazy this world is, how things don't exactly always fit into the lines here. Especially compared to horses' more risky world, I guess.
Right.
I guess I also really like that the shading on here is also used with a soft, textured brush, which also emphasizes the fluffiness, the softness, the cuteness, and especially with the character design of Centaurworld, a lot of characters are round, so they're so cute, and so silly, and really plays with their strengths of how they're animated too, because you're going to see the centaurs have a lot more cartoony animation, a lot more squash and stretch, a lot more... Why? No, no one's body can work like that. What? Stop. Please stop. But these designs, to order to make them work, and they don't look flat at all. And that's something that can be hard for artists to accomplish with this. In animation, you also got to think all angles of this character. Everything about this character, especially weird, something as weird as centaurs, especially in this really zany world. There gotta be some model sheets, baby. You just gotta be best. Mm-hmm. Zilius tells us, these model sheets are absolutely insane. Thanks for Evan Palmer, on Twitter, who actually was one of the lead character designers on the show. Look at this! Like, how do you think a horse can move all that? Like, they took... They were breaking the rules of how a horse works. But when you look at it, it kind of doesn't look wrong. Even though it's really wrong in real life, and, like, the horse would probably break so many bones. The way that they used appeal, especially when horse is, like, sticking your leg out, and, like, ugh! And it's like, what the heck? That looks really good! And you could sense the weight and volume of these characters. I think, like, the one where she's holding the swords, it's, like, saying that, like, she can just pick up things magically here. Be as ridiculous as you want. Which is absolutely amazing. They went really in-depth. I took some samples from some of the characters. Was it Humphrey? I forgot the giraffe man. I just only eat farts. That's all. That's all I know.
That's the character.
He wasn't as prominent in my viewing experience.
Let me think really quick, or I can just look it up.
Hold on, I'm thinking.
I'm thinking as I look it up.
Why you think? I just want to go interject. One of the things I loved, I think it was the first episode when, like, they actually bring attention to the fact that they're breaking the rules. When, like, Horace just, like, points and she's like, aha, look at that, I can point now.
Yeah.
Right. And that's almost like a subconscious thing that I only picked up rewatching the show and looking back at it, where the design notes that you're making, Baha, where it's like Horace comes from
about the last page.
Hmm?
I'm still talking about the last page.
Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, not you. It's just a slight switch. That's all I saw.
Oh, gotcha. Is that you do have a lot of the characters in the centaur world compared to the real one and the one that Horace came from. Everything is rounded there, but then Horace comes in and the design, like you mentioned, is so in stark contrast where it's sharpened in edges. And you don't really pick up on that at maybe all the time. Mm-hmm. Every once in a while you notice the contrast there, and that hits home with, to me, one of the themes that I mentioned earlier, which was the difference between these two worlds and the idea of a fish out of water. Yeah. So it helps stick that out even more. And people often talk about, like, silhouettes and everything and such and character designs. And I think that is definitely the situation there, where that's very noticeable if you look at the characters along. And it's like, one of these things is not like the other.
Yeah.
It's great. I love that contrast.
Real quick, we have about 10 minutes left.
Okay. So okay.
Wow, really?
I know.
So mainly what I wanted to say is that even though these characters are very cartoony and bouncing off the walls and stuff, you can tell that there's a lot of structure and a lot of sense of how anatomy works, especially looking at the characters. Like Glendale, how she twists. There's so much volume. It feels realistic, even though it's fake. You can tell the motions and the directions that they're going for. Even though that these characters are insanely cartoony, they still have the realistic-esque anatomy that they would have if they actually did exist. So, yeah.
Oh,
a quick brief overview.
I just want to really quickly add, based off of what Thot said and what you kind of touched on, Baha, this show has so much rewatch value. Like, you can go back and find things like, they pack so much into 22 minutes that you can go back and find things you didn't see on the first watch through. So,
absolutely.
It's amazing.
Relating to catching things on the second rewatch, the name of the giraffe is Derpleton.
Purpleton. Mm. He's so good. Yeah. I know I just said fart character. I might turn you off, but he's honestly such a sweetheart, and you should appreciate him.
Yep.
Although, speaking of farts, this show really likes butts. Just throwing that as an aside. I mean, look at that door. Why is that door so thick?
Are you sold yet?
They implement centaurs everywhere, even the most subtle ways. Like, those trees, on the whatever direction, you don't realize those are, like, briefly hinting the centaurs. Mm-hmm. But you can see kind of the legs and the way that they're laying down. The one before, like, you look at that for a brief second, you're like, oh, that's just a weird, like, mountain rock thing, and it's actually a centaur. I just really liked all the subtle background details, especially someone who is a background painter. For True Tale and prop designer. True Tale's like an animated thingy majig.
Absolutely.
Industry thing.
All right.
It's like they know you watch it for the plot.
Before jeez.
Sorry.
All right. Before there we run out of time here, I want to get we're gonna kick it over to Rose to talk about finding some personal meanings in the stories here. Now, this is going to be a little spoilery here.
Yeah, I was just gonna go say, yeah, this section, I'm kind of going all no hold barred here. So if you haven't seen the series and you're convinced that you want to go see the series, drop off now, watch it, and then there's probably a bot of this video somewhere. Anyway, I also want to go preface this that this is based off of my own personal viewing experience. I've rewatched like 3 times, and this is kind of what I personally have got out of it. You might get something similar, depending on many factors. But I want to talk about first this lovely character here, the most comfortable of Dougs. I mean, his name in itself, Comfortable Doug. You go to the next slide. All
right.
I will. He gets a song at the end. Basically explaining his life as Comfortable Dog. And two of the lines that I think really got to me were these two right here. I definitely feel that first one because it's like, I always feel like I'm just a supporting actor in somebody else's film, which is kind of stinks. So like, I love that in the song, he's like, I came out of my comfort zone and I put myself out there and like I won this sash and like I'm experiencing life, and now that he's comfortable with himself, he can share his essentially his love for himself with other people, and he makes a great point about how like if we're all comfortable with ourselves, then like we can essentially all be comfortable, for lack of better words.
Right.
And kind of transitioning to Horse's Journey.
Super spoiler moment coming.
This is where it gets super spoiler. Yep. So Horse goes through a little bit of a journey. So, you know,
TF time.
Yes. So this is where
where's Ace?
This is where TF fans can get a lot from this. But me personally, I'm trans. So transformation is kind of my life. Like we see here when Horse first starts her journey, she's a regular horse. She can't point. She can't talk. She's just a horse who crushes skulls. But later on, like, she starts getting more in touch with herself. She can now talk. She can do things that she wasn't able to before. And she starts inherently changing as a person or as a horse, what have you. And I know one of her biggest fears is, especially when she gets, like, her poofy hair and like she starts more conforming to the world of Centaurworld and becomes the little chubby cinnamon bun that you see in the bottom left and bottom right corners. Like, she's scared that she's made so many strides in herself that she worries that her rider isn't going to recognize herself. And that hits deep as someone who's trans, because it's like, you come to this realization that, like, dang, this is who I am. And, like, you worry about, like, your loved ones. I know I myself worried about Forward when I was first coming out. Like, how would he accept me? How would my parents accept me? Like, would they be able to recognize me after, like, you know, I started being more of myself? And I know she makes that full transition. I think we showed it a couple of slides before where, like, she has this big musical number after, like, wearing, like, what was it, like, fishnets and boots. Like, she goes the whole nine yards.
Oh, those boots with so the heels good. That kept growing.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And then...
Such a good song.
She just becomes so comfortable with herself, she just officially makes the final change into the bottom left. And I know at first, she's mortified because she's so... she's so worried, like, will Ryder be able to recognize me anymore? Like, am I the same horse that I used to be? And of course, her fears were unfounded. While Ryder did point a sword to her for just a little bit, like, once she started singing to her and she realized that, like, this is the horse that I've been riding my whole life, like, it's like no time has passed. Like, they're all hugs and, like, I can't believe you're finally here again. It's just like, it's very heartwarming, I guess, for me, because it's like that, it feels like a journey. And I don't think you put it in. There's an episode that deals with a very heavy subject, and this is a very heavy subject for someone who is going through a journey like Horse did, or even like I did, where people don't accept you, and you're so worried of people not accepting you that, unfortunately, people go down the realm of suicide. And there is an episode that kind of deals with that topic with one of the shamans, and it really hit home for me that they touched upon it, because I feel like it's something that needs to be talked about, but...
Depression and mental health in general is definitely a topic that the more that we discuss it as a culture, the more we can learn and grow and help one another. And it's definitely great to see some representation that doesn't shame, that says, you know, you can get through this and there are others who will understand.
And thankfully, you know, Wamawink had such, or not Wamawink, Horse had such a great support system in Wamawink that Wamawink managed to go pull her out of that depression and make her realize that, like, people are going to accept me no matter what I look like, no matter who I am. And I think that is such an important lesson to teach people. And yeah, the show really, really hit home on that front.
So I would love to dive so much more in. We should have asked for a 90-minute panel, guys.
Yeah,
I should have known if I got us together.
Maybe another convention. You never know. We could get another...
Nudge, nudge.
We've got to wrap up, but I want to thank everybody for joining us. If you loved what you heard, check out the series. You can always talk
Please.
To us. We're going to be all throughout here. Check out Baja in the vendor hall. Check out Bolt's set tonight. And we're going to be on various panels throughout the day. You can see on the screen now. One of them is in like 5 minutes. And it's mine in this very room. God. So we do have to wrap things up. I'm going to need to take about 5 minutes to cut the stream, reset up for the new panel, and then start streaming again in this very room. So if you're not tired of hearing my voice, stay tuned. I will be right back. I want to thank Miss Nova Rose for joining us. Where can people find you?
You can go find me at Nova Roselli on Twitter. And then you can find me at twitch.tv/Nova Roselli over on Twitch. I typically stream Mondays and Wednesdays with that lovely VTuber avatar. On the top, usually we play Genshin. I know the other night we played Jackbox. I'm going to be taking a slight hiatus because I have a procedure next week that'll probably put me out of commission for about a month, so hopefully I'll start being able to stream before a month, but we will see.
All right. Baja Griffin, thank you so much everything for this. Where can everybody find you?
I'm Baja Griffin nearly everywhere. I'm mostly active on Twitter.com. I'll be at Ciderfest and TrotCon this year, and also Equestria's Next Top Artist later on, where I battle a bunch of art friends. We're going to beat each other up. It's going to be fun.
Woo! It's going to be awesome. We're going to beat each other up.
It's going to be great.
I love beating up my friends.
Well, thank you for joining us.
No problem.
Absolutely. Thank you for having me. You can find me at Bolt the Super Pony pretty much everywhere. I'm on Twitter at Super Pony Bolt. In fact, actually, you can check out all my links in the vendor hall of this convention right here. I am just under the Bolt hashtag, and then all my links are posted. I've got a brand new Redbubble site as well. And you can see me tonight at the concert, 2:15 a.m. Eastern time. I'm going to be at Ciderfest and TrotCon as well if you want to say hi. And yeah, thank you guys so much for having me. This was fun.
And Thoth, thank you again.
Hi. Not a problem. It's always a pleasure. You can find me on three different places on Twitter. I'm at Thoth Penswell, at Riff Ponies. I'm one half of Riff Ponies. Hi. Follow them, definitely. Also follow TrotCon. Come to TrotCon anyway, however the order works. I'm one half of the social media there, so you can talk to me. You can send me Centaurworld memes. That's great. That's good. Me and Luck Rock will love that. You could see more of me and all the rest of my friends tonight. We're going to be doing Riffin' Rainbow in 2 hours. That'll be great. And we're going to be doing Equestria's Next Top Artist. Baja and Forward will be on that. It's going to be a great time. We're going to beat each other up. Other than that, we're going to be, we just got announced as community guests for Ponyville Ciderfest, Riff Ponies. So come to Ciderfest, but that's not the thing that I'm contractually obligated to say. What I am contractually obligated to say is, anyway, come to TrotCon. Thank you so much for having me on this.
All right, and last but not least, if you want to see more from me, check out the links on the screen, or just stay here. We're going to sign off for a few minutes, and I will be right back for Keeping Friendship Magic Generations. Thank you all. We love you guys. Thank you for being here, being a part of PonyFest, and we'll see you guys later. Take care, every pony.
Anyway, watch Centaurworld.
Yes.
Yeah, do that.
A huge thank you to our patrons, SamuDash, Jason Kuzmak, Statman Dan, Riftwing Designs, Frenchie McHugh, NeverendingNerd, and TheTopMostDog. Without your support, this project wouldn't be possible.